often see scratches all over his body, and on one occasion, Berliner had
poured
on him as he slept. So Mark did the right thing, and he left the relationship. He had also met somebody else. On the 2nd of September 2015, 21 days prior to Mark being found in the street, Berliner had gone onto her computer and began searching a certain topic, acid attacks. She looked at 82 cases of these attacks and what had happened to the victims. After she had browsed on some of the various sites, she went onto Amazon and was able to purchase a bottle of concentrated sulfuric acid. On this very same day, Mark called the police and told them that Berliner had been harassing him and his new girlfriend. Berliner had called Mark's new girlphone.
Yeah, you good now, Vince.
But when she picked up, Berliner wouldn't say
hello, good girl.
She would just stay silent in an attempt to be intimidating. Berliner had also told Mark that if he was ready to leave her,
where would your eye? What's that?
The police contacted Berliner and warned her to stop. Mark also called his father on this day too. He told his father that he was genuinely scared of Berliner. He explained about the scratches and the boiling water. He was fearful that she may do something else. Despite his fears, on the night of the 22nd of September, Mark went round to Berliner's flat to reiterate that their relationship was indeed over and to try and make some kind of amends. Mark had also decided to stay the night. At around 3 a.m. on September the 23rd, Mark was sleeping in bed. Berliner got up, walked into the kitchen, and poured some of the acid she had bought into a cup, and then returned to the bedroom. She woke up Mark, laughed at him,
are you gonna kick her?
Said, "If I can't have you, then nobody can." Berliner then threw a large quantity of concentrated sulfuric acid directly into Mark's face. Mark was instantly in a tremendous amount of pain. He was able to run outside, and the neighbors came to his assistance. They found him screaming in agony, begging for somebody to help him. The neighbors called the emergency
service,
and they told the operator that his ex-girlfriend had thrown
acid. You're not being nice, though.
They then assisted
guiding
him into a flat so he could take a cold shower to soothe the pain until the paramedics arrived. The paramedics arrived on the scene and found Mark in a horrendous state. He was foaming from the mouth and had extremely severe chemical burns on his face, chest, shoulders, arms, and legs. They quickly administered pain relief and rushed him to hospital. On the journey there, Mark was repeatedly saying that he couldn't see anything. The paramedic looked into his eyes only to see that one of his irises had dissolved. Mark told the paramedics exactly who was responsible for doing this to him. He begged for the police to go and check on his new girlfriend. He was told that she too could have suffered the same thing. The police made their way over to Berliner's flat, and inside, they found her just sitting on the sofa. She was, of course, quickly arrested. The police checked on Mark's new girlfriend, and thankfully, she was absolutely fine. When Mark arrived at the hospital, he was able to catch a glimpse of himself and saw the extent of his injuries. Mark screamed and stated that he no longer wished to live. Mark had to be put into a coma for 4 months due to the extent of his
Rocky injuries. I have to get you a cradle. You knew your baby bird. You knew cradle.
His lower left leg, so much in fact that it needed to be amputated. The sulfuric acid had continued to burn, not only through the skin and muscle, but also all the way down to the bone. The acid had destroyed the membrane surrounding them, and some of Mark's bones were full of cavities.
Give me your big butt. Give me your big butt.
Terrible amount of pain. Mark's nose had been completely destroyed, along with one of his ears, too. The police searched for Mark's family so they could contact them and let them know what had happened. His family lived in the Netherlands, so it took around 10 days, but they were able to find them. Once hearing the news, his family rushed to his side to be with him. When Mark's father arrived, the hospital staff told him where he could find Mark. He perhaps didn't fully know the extent of Mark's injuries, as when he arrived on the ward, he looked for his son, but couldn't see him anywhere. He returned to the desk and told them they had eventually came out of the coma, and when he did, he only had movement in his mouth and tongue. He communicated by sticking out his tongue when his father pointed to a letter on an alphabet board. After some time in recovery, he was able to start talking again, but he was paralyzed from the neck down. Mark became deeply depressed. The pain, the trauma, and not being able to move took a huge toll on his mental health. Mark's injuries were so severe that the police decided that the pictures should never be released. From now on, Mark would need a lifetime of constant and dedicated care. On the 22nd of November 2016, a care home was found for Mark in Gloucester. Only one night at this care home, Mark called his father and pleaded with him to come to Gloucester.
Hurt you a little bit.
800 miles to his son at the home. Once he entered, he found Mark in his room, covered in his own feces. Mark's father promised him
he would get
him out of there as soon as possible. Mark's family and friends were able to hire a private ambulance and managed to get Mark back to his country. They found him a care home with much better care.
Nobody.
If things weren't already
how you doing,
enough,
huh? Mark how you doing, old guy?
Infection. A tube needed to be inserted into his throat to remove liquid. The operation would mean that Mark would no longer be able to talk. Speaking to his family was the only thing.